Hey everyone, I'm Anya Esma, and today we are going to do a fun little exploration of tarot and witchcraft. Namely, which tarot card is connected to which kind of magic. So I want to start this off by saying that this is just a fun little exercise that I made up myself. I really just thought about it and wrote down all of my thoughts about what kinds of magic might go with which tarot card. And I'm going to explain to you how to use this video, which also means you can probably watch it in its entirety if you want to. If you find that interesting, if you want to know about all the tarot cards and all the kinds of magic. But I'm just saying that this is not gospel or anything. This is just something I made up because it was fun, because it was creative, and because I wanted to think about which tarot card might be connected to which kind of witchcraft or which kind of spell work or occultism, etc. If you have thoughts on that in the comments, just tell me. If you think I'm wrong about any card, if you want to add something to it, just tell me, because this is literally just a little exercise that I want to do with you rather than at you, where I tell you the truth of everything and what you need to do. That's really not what this is about. It's just me rambling, going through the things that I made up, and you can go along and learn about it. So, which magical practice you should try based on your soul card? That's what I named the video, but you can also use the video in other ways. So the first way is obviously that you look at your soul card, you calculate your soul card, and we'll start by figuring that out together. By the way, I will explain how to get to that number. If you already know that, you can skip that part, but that comes later. I've made a list basically for each card of magical ideas, of inspiration. And that's really what I want you to take from this video, inspiration. Whether you use it in this first way, where you calculate your soul card and look at the card, or whether maybe you draw a card from your deck, that's something you can do as well. You just tell your deck, give me some magical inspiration, what could I do? You just take the major arcana cards, sort all the other 56 cards out of there, and then you just draw whatever card comes up, and you can go to that part of this video. Or the third way you can use this video is also that you can just watch it in its entirety. That's kind of course, selfishly what I hope people will do, because that helps the algorithm the most. So if you're interested in tarot and witchcraft, maybe it's worth it to watch the whole video and not just watch what pertains to you. I think nowadays we have this tendency to always skip everything that does not concern us, in the sense that if we look at zodiac signs, or if we look at tarot cards, or if we look at, I don't know, some people are into human design, I'm not, but some people are, or they're into 16 personalities, you always just look at the one that applies to you, and you kind of forget to look at the full picture and the full meaning of that tool or that method. And I think a lot gets lost if you do that. So my recommendation is selfishly to watch the whole video, but you can do that at your own wisdom, at your own, how do you say that again? Discernment. Discernment. Also, if you like this video, please like it. Also, selfishly saying this, and you can subscribe to me or turn on that bell thing if that still exists, if you want to see more of my face talking about tarot, about witchcraft, about creativity, about spirituality, and all those good things. So first of all, let's calculate your soul card together. As I said, if you know your soul card, you can skip this part. If you like hearing me talk, you can also watch it. But anyways, first of all, you need your birth date, and you add all of the numbers together. Let's say you're born on 18th December of 1990, you would add the 1, the 8, the 1, the 2, the 1, the 9, and the 0 together. 0 obviously doesn't add anything, but doesn't matter. So in that example, you would get 31. Because 31 is above 22, and we only have 22 cards in the major arcana, You would then take another sum. So the 31 becomes 3 plus 1, which becomes 4. So then you know your card, 4, the Emperor. Now that means that your personality card and your soul card aren't separate. However, in a different example, if you were born on 18th February 2000, then you would have 1 plus 8 plus 2 plus 2, which is 13. So this is where it gets interesting, because 13 is now your personality card, sort of what's outward, and 3 plus 1 again is 4, so your soul card would be the Emperor as well, but your personality card would be Death. Kind of the same, but yes, so 13 would make your soul card the 4, which is the Emperor. I hope that makes sense. I hope I'm explaining this well. So now you can look at both cards. You can just look at your soul card. You can do whatever you want. Now, maybe you're wondering, how do I get the Fool then? Because the Fool is 0 and there is no way that you can get the 0 as your soul or personality card. Well, in tarot, there's 21 cards that are numbered and then the 0, and we take it as the 22nd card. So if your sum of your birthday is 22, that is when you have the Fool. But that then also relates back to the 4. Again, the Emperor. So then you also have two cards to look at. But yeah, obviously, if you are born in the 2000s, your numbers are going to be a lot lower, because you don't have the 1990 or 1980 higher numbers adding a lot to that. So if you were born before the millennium, you probably have quite a high number. And then if you were born after it, your number might be a bit lower. Okay, that's everything. So now hopefully you can calculate your soul card. There's also soul card calculators online. Of course, you can also use those. So without further ado, let's talk about what I made up about what kinds of magic are related to the different cards. Let's start with number one. If your soul card or personality card is the 1, you have the Magician as the tarot card that is linked to that. Obviously, the Magician is the card of magic. And if you look at the card in your deck or in the Rider-Waite-Smith, the traditional deck, a lot of the time it is very ceremonial looking. So what this card might point to is that you might have a talent for ceremonial magic, or you might just want to look more into that and see if anything speaks to you. So I would recommend looking up online ceremonial magic, seeing some examples of it. Of course, it could also mean that you want to go through kind of a formal education, because to become a magician, you can, of course, join a coven of witches or a coven of Wiccans or anyone who practices witchcraft and then be educated in their secrets. I think that's also something relating to the Magician. So in the card, you see a whole setup with an altar, a super planned ceremony, probably with the tools laid out, ready to be used, with the words he says, the movement he makes, probably very planned out. So I've always felt that the Magician is not so much about making intuitive spell work like spontaneously, but rather having a ceremony planned out that you follow. So this might also be a card that is calling you to ritualize your practice more. Sometimes we slip into these slumpy slumps where we just kind of do nothing in magic, or we just like do the basics that we know, but we don't really have any ritual or structure behind it. So this card could also mean that your spell work needs more ritualized repetition, building an altar that you always go to, so you have a routine with that, or doing a spell that takes a little bit longer, so every day you add a little bit to it and you build these ritualized behaviors. The Magician is also about a channel, about being a channel for the divine, because if you look at him, he usually has his arm up like this and one arm down, so you have the whole logic of as above, so below. That's a sentence that is very common in occult magic, and you can look that up yourself, learn more about it, and the magician is tied to that. So it is a channel for the divine or whatever you believe in for messages to come through. So this may also point you towards channeling information or channeling beings, channeling whatever you believe in through meditation, or asking guidance from the universe and putting that into action in your life. It could also mean bringing those ideas that you get from above into the physical through making art. Whether that's writing, painting, anything, you're the channel that brings the ideas into the physical, which is related to this whole idea of manifestation that the magician stands for. So yes, try to ritualize your practice. Look into occult magic if you want, as above, so below, as a keyword. Make art as a channel for the divine and just be magical. That's it for the magician. I know that was a lot. I think this was the longest number that I will talk about the longest, because there's just so much to the magician relating to witchcraft. What I don't see in the magician, interestingly, is the whole idea of, at least myself, like herbalism, being connected to the earth. It's very much more about the kind of mental and spiritual aspects of witchcraft. So keep that in mind as well, that maybe that is pointing towards this like earth-related practice not being so relevant in your life, and it's more about the spiritual or the mental practice. I also want to note that the cards may point you towards strengths or weaknesses, which doesn't mean that you shouldn't do certain things. It just means you might be more talented at others, and you can use that to also boost your skills in the areas where you're not as good. So it could point to natural talent or something that you should focus on in your craft rather than something else, like not focusing on something that is not related to the card, but rather focusing your energy on something that the card is supporting you in. If your soul or personality card is number 2, that means it's the High Priestess, a wonderful card that is, of course, beloved by witches all around. It is the card of intuition and of connecting with inner wisdom rather than outer wisdom. So what this is saying is that the knowledge that you might need in your practice right now is not to be found in books, but within yourself. So this could be a suggestion to learn divination and really delve deep into divination. All kinds, really. It can be scrying, it can be tarot, it can be runes that you work with for divination. Anything like that that sharpens your intuition, that is what the High Priestess really points you towards. It could also be fire scrying, it could be smoke scrying, you could look at the clouds and read them, you can get a crystal ball, you can read tea leaves, you can read coffee grounds. There's divination everywhere in life, and life really has the meaning that you give it and the meaning that you see in it, and the High Priestess is very much a call to tune into that information that is all around you and open your mind to that, not just in the moments of divination, but also in all other moments of your life. The information that is coming in into your core, or that is coming from inside to the outside, because the outside gives us the inspiration and the inside brings up a feeling or inspiration, thoughts, anything that you can then work with. So the High Priestess could be a pointer towards something in your subconscious mind trying to come to the surface, or just that you are very connected to your subconscious mind and you're very naturally talented at that. Shameless plug here, if you want to learn more about divination, I have a lot of videos about tarot. I don't think I've made one about runes. Nope. But about tarot, my channel is a good place to start. So sharpening your intuition and placing more meaning on your psychic abilities is what the High Priestess is pointing towards. If you drew the card just now, it might be saying do more of that. If that is your soul card, it might say that you have a natural talent for that. And also using those insights that you have and those psychic abilities to share insights with others and to share wisdom with others. Because a high priestess doesn't exist in isolation. A high priestess exists for other people to go to her to ask for advice. So think about whether you actually follow your intuition or it's more of a background noise that you tend to ignore, because that's something that even experienced witches sometimes struggle with. You can also do exercises for sharpening your intuition and psychic abilities. There's books about that. There's exercises for it. There's, you know, meditations online to sharpen your intuition. And just practice consciously tuning into your intuition. Even for small decisions like which tea you want to make, really go within yourself and see what tea resonates, what tea feels good, what decision feels good. So expressing the High Priestess even in the small parts of your everyday life is very important. The High Priestess is of course also associated with the moon and with water, because in many cards there's water pictured behind her. So think about working with lunar cycles more, lunar magic around the new moon, around the full moon, but also with the waning and waxing moon can be very powerful. And the High Priestess is pointing towards that. You can also make moon water during a full moon. That's an easy exercise that really brings together both aspects of the High Priestess, the moon aspect and the water aspect. And then using that moon water either to work with in a spell, to scry with, to drink it. That is like the ultimate sum up of the High Priestess. So I would definitely recommend doing that. And of course, you can also do a ritualistic bath during a full moon, or you use the moon water to do the bath. Anything that relates to the water and moon and relaxation and intuition, all of that is the High Priestess calling you to do. So if your card number is 3, you have the Empress. The Empress is all about earth-based magic, of course. If you look at the card, it usually has some sort of harvestable greens like wheat, and she is sitting in nature most of the time. Sometimes she is also pictured as being pregnant. So with the Empress, we have this idea of creation and of earth and of harvest. So what does that mean for our magic? It means that creation-based magic could be for you, like creating a servitor that would support you in any task that you want to get done, or it gets obstacles out of the way for the task that you want to get done. If you don't know what a servitor is, you can just look that up online. I'm not going to explain all of that now, but you are essentially creating a thought form that supports you in your everyday life, or in your magic, or in your mental health, anything like that. And because the Empress is about fertility and creation, I think that's a good place to start. It could also be about venerating nature, connecting with nature, going out in nature, providing nurturing for spirits in nature. If you believe in fairies, for example, or any other elemental force, that's a good way to connect with the earth, to connect with nature, and the Empress is calling you to do that. Another thing is herb magic. For example, planting a seed with an intuition can be a powerful spell. With an intention. Planting a seed with an intention is like the classical green witch thing to do, and it really fits well with the image we have of the Empress. It could also be about nurturing yourself or others through kitchen witchcraft. So making a meal out of harvested goods from the earth, like a natural meal. It's very related to the Empress, and putting some magic into that, like just stirring the spoon in a certain way, creating a sigil with a spoon, writing in the food with a spoon as you cook it, as you stir it. That's something that is related to the Empress and this idea of nurturing, creating, and earth. It brings it all together very well. Recommend. If your card is number 4, that is the Emperor. So that could point towards you being supposed to take a leadership role in magical communities sooner or later, because the emperor does have its empire. That empire can be other people, it can also just be a business that you own, but it is something that you own with your magical abilities. So your magic is very much related to the real world. It's not just about the spiritual, like with the magician. It's very much about an empire existing in some way. Whether that is a community that you lead or a business that you lead, it could be any of those. Of course, the emperor is related to fire energy. It's associated with Aries. So it can be about leading others with magic and using fire magic to further your goals. I think specifically using fire magic, like for example, candle magic or burning your intentions or using fire smoke to cleanse or to scry, all of that is related to the emperor, especially if you use it for the greater good, because the emperor has responsibility in his power. The emperor is using magic for greater good and for taking responsibility, such as doing a spell for guarding freedom or guarding ownership or guarding the well-being of animals, of humans, of whole nations. It's very tied to activism, in my opinion, because the emperor has its empire, his empire to protect. So protection magic and fire magic are very related to that. The Hierophant is number 5. And that could be a pointer towards bringing religion into your practice if you feel comfortable with that. So for example, it could be about working with religious figures like Mother Mary or Kali from Hinduism, anything relating to religion and tying that back to witchcraft has to do with the Hierophant, in my opinion. I know a lot of people have religious trauma and don't want anything to do with it, but sometimes it's worth it to think about how our witchcraft can be empowered by religious implications, religious figures, or even religious rituals, like saying the Hail Mary or using certain methods of prayer, like in Islam. All of these things can inform witchcraft. Of course, that is not according to the books that people might rely on if they are very strictly religious, but it's your craft, it's your magic, and you can decide to take from the big religions as you see fit for your practice. And I do not see that as cultural appropriation if it's the biggest religions out there anyways, especially if it's the religion that you followed anyways. That holds a lot of power if you can turn that into something magical for you later down the line in your life. The Hierophant could also be pointing towards you needing some spiritual guidance, so needing to find someone to teach you. It could be online, physical, or even in your mental space. So it could also be a good pointer towards doing magic in meditation and asking for guidance or asking for a master with beneficial intentions to show up for you and to kind of show you the path. Because the Hierophant can be about your own informed actions and your own authority, but it can also be about the authority of others helping you find the magical path that is right for you or giving you the inspiration you need. Even as I'm sitting here, I'm kind of embodying a little bit of a Hierophant simply because I'm explaining things. I'm not saying their ultimate truth, which would be a very Hierophant thing to do, but still, that energy is something that is somehow related to your magical journey right now. Card number 6, the Lovers, can be about love spells. Of course, I think that's the first thing that comes to everyone's mind. It is associated with Gemini. The Lovers are associated with Gemini, which means that it is all about relations. It can be about relations to others, but it can also be about relationship with the self. And also, the card is highly associated with air, because Gemini is an air sign as well. So I would say using words, using logic, using speaking or using writing in your magic is very potent right now. And also a mirror would make sense, because with Gemini you have this idea of two people basically looking at each other. So relating inwardly to yourself and relating outwardly to other people. So doing that through mirror work can be super helpful if the Lovers is the card you drew. Especially talking to yourself in the mirror, saying affirmations in the mirror, because those are related to words, and air energy can be powerful here. I think it's also the idea of not needing tools for spells, because Gemini is such a sign of words and of the mental space and intelligence, and not the practical, not the hands-on, I'm doing a ritual with 10 different ingredients, but rather I'm sitting down journaling, writing, thinking, speaking to myself, to others. All of that has magic, and that's the magic that Gemini or the Lovers relate to here. So using spells for harmony and for confluence in relationships can also be a thing here. Love spells, yes. I'm not the biggest fan of love spells if they infringe on other people's free will, but you can also do a self-love spell, or you can simply do a spell like a glamour spell of self-love that makes you radiate the energy that you feel about yourself outwardly so that other people feel more lovingly towards you as well. The Lovers, of course, can also be related to sex magic, so that is something that you could dabble in. I don't know if I'm allowed to say that word on YouTube, actually. Sex magic. Sex magic. There we go. Okay, six cards down, a lot to go. So let's talk about the Chariot, card number 7. If your card is number 7, that's the Chariot. The Chariot is a card of manifestation, really. A card of achieving your goals, achieving what you want through magic and inspired action. So if you have that card as a soul card, it could point towards you having a natural talent for manifesting what you want in your life through magic. That could also mean that this is drawing you towards journaling about what you even want, because sometimes the Chariot tends to want things that it doesn't really need or require or that are good for them. So figuring out what you really want through journaling, figuring out your will and your wishes can be very powerful, and then doing a spell to conquer any obstacles. Because the Chariot is often about getting obstacles out of the way and having a free, aligned way of acting. Chariot is really about aligning your actions, your magic, your spirituality, your mental space, your physical space. Everything is aligned with each other. And it could be a pointer towards checking whether that is the case, because sometimes we do spell work and then we don't do anything for that spell work to have effect in reality. For example, if you cast a spell to find a new job and then you just sit around and don't write any applications, you can't expect it to just fall into your lap. And the Chariot is a reminder of that. The Chariot is really about manifesting through the confluence of your will, your what you set your mind to, and your actions and your magic. As to what kind of magic I would say is associated with Chariot, honestly, I know it's associated with the sign of Cancer and water, but I just don't get it. I don't know why it's like that. Like, I don't know who made that up, and it just shows to me that the connection between tarot and astrology is sometimes very flawed. We sometimes try to make things fit that just do not fit. I would say I would associate it with fire magic. You can also associate it with water magic, as it is connected to Cancer. But then again, it's really any kind of magic for manifesting. So for example, burning your intentions, burning your obstacles in a cauldron could also be an idea if you want to use fire magic to bring yourself ahead on your path. It's really about the whole mentality of going with the head through the wall and achieving that through magic, but in a reflected way, in a way where you don't just do the things that you think you want, but you truly know what you require and what's right for you. If your card number is 8, you have the Strength card. The Strength card is associated with fire and with the sign of Leo. So it's a lot about inner strength and courage that you find through shadow work, through self-reflection, and through knowing your inner demons, as some people call it. I don't like calling it that, but that's basically what the Strength card really stands for. It can also relate to ancestral work, because if you know yourself very well, that has a lot to do with generational trauma, with your ancestors and their influence on you. So the Strength card could point towards a natural talent or a need for ancestral healing and ancestral work, but also working with your own inner child, because that's sort of sometimes the lion that you have to tame. That's where the lions within yourself come from. So the goal with Strength is really to do so much shadow work, ancestral work, self-reflection, and doing magic related to that. Maybe doing magic to reveal more parts of you that you need to know, or to see the good in the parts that maybe scare you, like the lion. It can also be about sun magic, because as I said, it's related to Leo, to fire, to the sun. So the Strength card could mean that you use sun magic to cast light on those aspects that you maybe cannot see yet. Oftentimes, if you do shadow work or ancestral work, it's very useful to do a spell alongside that for beneficial information to be revealed to you, because that way you will know things, even if you maybe don't know much about your ancestors, or you don't even know your family, or you don't want to know them, you don't want to talk to them. You can use magic, you can use meditation, inner child work to really connect with that, even though you have no contact in the physical realm. So that's what the Strength card might be pointing you to. The Hermit is the 9th card. And if you have the number 9, that is definitely about introspection, about shadow work, maybe also mirror work, just like the Lovers. It can be about engaging with yourself rather than with others, and getting to know all the parts of yourself. Strength and the Hermit are very connected. So you could look at the Strength card as well, just like with the Strength card, you can look at the Hermit, because they kind of inform each other and inform this idea of inner work, of shadow work. But the Hermit is much more about being a recluse and not letting information from others get to you. Whereas the Strength card can be about magic that relates to ancestors, that relates to everything you're connected to. And the Hermit is more about finding yourself without any of the other things that the outside world wants you to be. So doing mirror magic, journeying in your mind without the need to go outside or to have a fancy ritual, just using your mind to travel within yourself, to learn about yourself, going in your mind to one of those lost and remote places that the Hermit is associated with, and then asking for insights there, going into a mental meditation in your own mind, journeying there and meditating there, and asking for insights about yourself, about any struggles that you might have, about influences from the outside and which ones you should ignore and which ones you should follow. That's very much the kind of magic that the Hermit is about. And also, secondly, protection magic, of course, because the Hermit has their own space, their own remote, little, encapsulated place where they do their work. So doing protection magic with the elements or with whatever beings you believe in can be beneficial here too. That could be something that you're very good at if that is your soul card. Let's talk about card number 10, the Wheel of Fortune. With the Wheel of Fortune, we have all elements kind of mixed in that. So in contrast to the other cards, you don't have a clear zodiac sign or a clear element that is just associated with this card. So in its diversity and in its richness of facets, it is really perfect for elemental magic. If you look at the card, you have all the different elements sort of expressed in the card. And I think what brings all of that together is a good thunderstorm spell, because with a thunderstorm spell, you have all elements. I've done that before and it's great, because you have fire because of the lightning, you have wind, air obviously everywhere, you have water because of the rain, and earth is just kind of always there. So you have all four elements really coming together in such a powerful way. And I feel like that perfectly expresses the Wheel of Fortune. So this might be a call to do a good old-fashioned thunderstorm spell. Since it is the Wheel of Fortune, it could be about change. It could be about opening a door to something new. It could also be about protection from fate and from the terrible things that can happen to you. You cannot stop them maybe, but you can kind of soften the blow maybe through a protection spell. So all of that is related to the Wheel of Fortune. It can also be a powerful healing spell. I once did a spell to heal myself and also back into my ancestral line during a thunderstorm, which was very powerful. So harness the power of all elements in your magic, or in your next spell at least, if the Wheel of Fortune is coming up for you or is your soul card. It means that you're really talented maybe with all elements, working with them at the same time, calling all of them in when you do a spell, and maybe even casting a circle, which includes calling upon all the elements. I don't always recommend that. I don't recommend it for everyone. It's unnecessary for some people to do, but for some people it's a powerful thing. So if you relate to the Wheel of Fortune in some way, or to the number 10 that it represents, it can be about working heavily with elemental magic, working heavily with nature, with thunderstorms, with representations of the elements on your altar, or just representations of the elements during a spell. So doing a candle spell, which also includes water, maybe the candle is swimming on something, maybe you also include salt for the earth, and you blow out the candle to symbolize something, so you have air. So that's what I mean when I say working with all elements. But it can mean so much more than that, as you can imagine. So look into that. Let's talk about card 11, which is Justice in the Rider-Waite-Smith tarot deck. And of course, the first thing that comes to mind is justice, is karma and karmic balance of the good and the bad deeds that you may have committed, the energies that surround you or others. I think this is pointing towards, rather than you pushing yourself to wish for an extreme in your spells, to try to manifest an extreme, something that is extremely outlandish or extremely contrary to who you are. Let's say you are a very quiet person and you do a spell for being a complete extrovert suddenly. Rather than doing that, cast a spell for balance, because that's what justice is about. It's about balance, the middle path, finding a way to relate to things that is not either that nor that. It's a way that includes all perspectives. That is what justice is about. So it could also be about using divination to see other perspectives for a situation or for your whole life. But in general, do spells that try to bring about harmony, justice, balance. Since it's associated with Libra, you could also make a ritualistic spell that includes a scale or also a sword, because both of those things are associated with justice. So those could be two important tools for you, or one of them could be important to you in your spellcraft. And in general, I would tend towards water magic or earth magic for this. I know Libra is an air sign, but the vibe that justice gives, it's also a little bit grounded, you know, balanced and grounded, kind of like Temperance, which I will get to later because that's card 14. But yes, so using water or earth magic to bring about harmony and balance and justice in the universe. So just like with the Emperor, we could also have this idea of activism coming into your witchcraft here. If justice is the card that you feel drawn to or that is your soul card, then it could mean that you should use your spell work to bring justice, freedom, well-being to animals, humans, nations, all of that. And using your magic in that sense rather than just for yourself or balance within your own life. So it's a very powerful card, but it's also a selfless card of seeing other perspectives, of getting educated about other perspectives, of arguing for other perspectives and not just for your own. That's what justice is about. So it's kind of contrary to the whole idea of just introspection, just getting to know yourself, just looking at what applies to you, and rather seeing more than that. And using your magic for that information to be revealed to you and for more justice to come into the world. I just realized I'm only done with half the cards and my voice is already feeling... You know that feeling when it feels just croaky and tired? If your card is number 12, that is the Hanged Man. Since this card is very restricted in movement, it could point to your magic not needing a lot of tools and a lot of things in the physical, but to be more in the mental sphere, that you do magic in your mind, in your fantasy, as you are journeying, astral traveling, you are doing your magic. So I think the Hanged Man could point towards a talent for astral traveling because the real world is restricting. The Hanged Man is also very much about exploring and gaining enlightenment within the own mind. So it makes sense to associate it with exploring your inner world, with astral traveling, journeying in your fantasy, in your mind, working internally with different guides or your inner child and gaining knowledge and a rounded out magical practice through that, rather than just focusing on the outside, focusing on making a pretty altar or using all the elements around you, connecting to them. That's not really what the Hanged Man is about. It's more about the whole mental aspect of magic. It could also mean to do some magic that helps you let go of control and surrendering and opening yourself to new information that might be shocking, but it helps you learn that you cannot control everything and that sometimes you need to surrender to the flow of life and depend on yourself and on your mind to be there to catch you. It can also be about sacrifice. So maybe if you draw the Hanged Man, it would be good to do a spell that includes some sort of sacrifice. It could be something physical, like you write a poem and then burn it, or you paint a picture and then bury it somewhere or burn it as well. It could also be sacrificing a certain part of your life, like, I don't know, sacrificing sweets if you really like sweets, or stopping smoking, something like that. So sacrificing that and then dedicating that sacrifice to an intention that you have, to something, a goal that you want to achieve. So making the sacrifice itself part of a spell. Now for number 13, we have the Death card, which is associated with Scorpio and with the element of water. Death is like the ultimate occult card for many people, and so no wonder that it is associated with Pluto and with Scorpio, both also heavily associated with magic, with occult magic especially. So it's basically the card of occultism. So it might mean that you feel naturally drawn to or you're skilled at occult magic, and that's something that you should really lean into. Now, what occult magic exactly is, you can just look that up online, learn more about it. I would say it's a little bit different from witchcraft because it's a little bit more lofty. It's not so much like many witches connected to nature, the earth, the elements. Well, I wouldn't say not connected to the elements, but you know, occultism is very much about the higher magic, or what people want to call higher magic, a little bit detached from earth and from natural cycles and anything that connects us with the physical world. The occult is more lofty, more airy. So this card might also mean that you have a need for ancestral work, because obviously death is also about the dead. It can also mean that you have a talent for speaking to the dead, as some people do, or just seeing beyond the veil, getting information, whether it's through divination or meditation, or simply when you don't even want it, getting information from beyond beyond the visible physical world. I would also say chaos magic is very associated with the occult. It's kind of a modern version of occultism. Maybe some people would kill me for saying that, but that's kind of how I see chaos magic a lot of the time. And it's very important to do spell work for new beginnings and endings. The whole idea of rebirth and of transformation is so intertwined with the card of death, but also Scorpio and Pluto. So maybe think about doing spell work around that, especially using your intuition, using water magic, maybe water scrying could be for you to get information from beyond the veil, from your subconscious, from people who have passed on, exploring the whole idea of death, beginnings, endings, and transformation. That's the meaning that magic could have in your life. If you have card number 14, that is Temperance. Temperance is associated with Sagittarius for some reason. It's another one of those associations where I'm like, should you really try to make astrology and tarot fit together, or does it sometimes just not fit? So just like the Justice card, Temperance is very much about creating balance physically and mentally and spiritually. So doing magic around balance, around not finding an extreme that you want to work towards, but rather bringing balance into your life. So it could point towards you requiring to do a spell that takes away the focus from something that takes up a lot of your life, and kind of letting that go and surrendering a bit more, surrendering control and finding more peace and balance within. So especially water magic can help with that, because water is very calming. So especially doing something like a cleansing bath could be helpful here to cast for balance. It could also mean that you should incorporate all four elements. So if you take a ritualistic bath, put some salt in it, which stands for earth, light a candle, and for the whole air part, well, air is always there, but you could use words to represent air. So taking all of that into the bath with you that is meant to bring balance, that's what this card could point to. I'm not sure what natural talent it could point to. Temperance is a card that I do not have the best relationship with. So if you have ideas in the comments, please, please, please tell me what Temperance could point towards as a natural magical talent. I think it's worth it to refer back to the Justice card, because a lot of the subjects are related, like seeing perspectives through divination, and gaining a new perspective about the world by incorporating everything rather than just looking at yourself. So it's not a card of doing just self-focused magic and manifestation magic, but a card of bringing about balance in the greater context of the world as well. Card number 15 is the Devil. A very interesting card, and I would say people who have this as a soul card might have a natural talent for shadow work and self-honesty, because this card is also the card of self-deception a lot of the time, and the people who are the most honest with themselves and the most reflected often have great talent for lying to themselves and deceiving themselves in ways that a normal person probably could not comprehend. So having that talent as kind of a double-edged sword and looking out for true reflection and shadow work is very important, incorporating that in your practice. So be mindful of using magic maybe to break unhealthy habits, because the devil is also the card of addictions, like smoking, phone addiction, any addiction really to a substance, a person, a lifestyle. It could be any addiction, anything you depend on to give you a good feeling that is not truly good in your core. So doing magic for living an aligned life without those unhealthy habits is important, and not just following what other people do. This means your magic will be highly, highly personal. I wouldn't say it needs to be fire magic, it needs to be earth magic, or it needs to be a candle spell, it needs to be mirror work. Yes, it should incorporate shadow work because that's kind of tied to the devil, but I wouldn't box in a person who has that as a soul card because it's so individualistic. Once again though, this card makes me think of chaos magic because it is so much about willpower and about shaping the physical world. So using magic for manifestation, but truly, truly reflecting on what you need and want in yourself and not just outwardly what you think others might have and you want it too. So using magic to reveal to you your life purpose, detached from the addictions and unhealthy habits that you might have. Something greater, finding something greater through magic. That is what the devil relates to. Number 16, the Tower. Of course, that kind of speaks to a talent for fire magic, a talent for burning things down and maybe rebuilding them, burning things down without remorse, letting go of things. And I think this is super related both to fire magic, like burning things in your cauldron or doing a candle spell where you let the candle absolutely burn down. Don't turn it off beforehand. It needs to go down all the way like the tower. And it can also be related to cleansing magic. Magic to clean your home, to get rid of stale or old energies. I think if the tower is your soul card, you would have a natural talent for cleansing, because that is all about destructing the bad, destructing something that has grown beyond its prime and needing to be pruned down. So cleansing magic, fire magic, that's what the tower is pointing towards. I can't think of anything else. I feel like that's not enough. So if you can think of something else for the tower, do tell me in the comments. Number 17 is the Star. So that's a lot. The Star is a very intense card. Of course, it has to do with healing and healing magic. To heal yourself or to heal others is probably one of the main uses of magic, besides manifestation. Many people use magic for manifestation to get what they want, but many people use magic for healing. And if you have the Star as your soul card, you would have probably a natural talent for using magic to heal others and the self. But the Star is also associated with Aquarius, and Aquarius is all about the collective vision for a new world and for idealism. That's what it stands for. So creating a new world with magic, once again, we have this idea of activism in your magic, of healing the world, not just yourself or some people around you with your magic, but healing the world with your magic. Of course, the Star is also associated with water very heavily, so your healing spells might incorporate water. It might incorporate scrying with water. It might incorporate cleansing with water, using cleansing sprays around your home as well, or also steaming. Steaming is also sort of a magical transformational thing because you transform water into steam. It changes its liquidity, it changes its state. So that can be transformative as well when used in a spell. It can be a great metaphor for healing. And essentially, you just want to be the bridge between the unseen and the seen if you have the star card. To be like a guiding light for others, both for yourself and for others, actually. I think also sound magic could be interesting here. So using either music, certain vibrations, or also chanting for healing, or using sound baths with, you know, like those singing bowls that there are. Do you call them singing bowls in English? I'm not sure. And also creating art. So the star is like any healing capacity within magic is relevant. Art, creativity, activism, water magic, all of that is related to the star. Number 18 is the moon. So I think it's quite obvious that I will say that lunar magic plays a huge role here. Your relationship with the moon, if the moon card is your soul card, is probably central to your magical practice. That means observing lunar cycles, observing how you react to those lunar cycles of waxing, waning, full moon, new moon, and harnessing the power of each of those phases to create your magical practice. So in a lot of ways, it would be a practice that is full of routine. So the moon can also just be a call to bring more routine into your practice, because the moon is cyclical, or the moon cycle is cyclical or cyclical. I'm not a native speaker, don't come for me. But creating cycles within your practice, probably inspired by the moon, is what you should do. Now, what kind of magic can you do? Of course, creating moon water, using that moon water to bathe, drinking it, or using that moon water to enhance your dreams as well, because the moon is also related to the dream world. So doing dream magic, training lucid dreaming could be meaningful for you. Or even just asking for insights before you dream. Oftentimes it doesn't work, but maybe if you have a natural talent for it, it will work like 8 out of 20 times. Where if you ask for specific insights before you sleep, you are able to get those through your dreams. Or you maybe have a lucid dream where you can ask the places or people in your dream what something means, or you can ask them for help. I think the moon is also related to shadow work and introspection. Intuition, of course, kind of like the High Priestess, so you could also refer back to the High Priestess card. So yes, it can be about journaling, about sitting with emotions, because journaling is very word centric and I feel like the moon isn't much about words. It's about intuition and feeling and healing yourself through feeling emotions, which is also a magical alchemical process. So that's what the moon card might be calling you to do. Card number 19, the sun. Of course, we have solar magic here. Many witches just work with the moon. I just spoke about the moon in the last card, but you can also work with the sun, because the sun can reveal a lot that is hidden. It can reveal parts of you, or it can reveal the root cause of certain bad habits you might have. It can reveal anything you wanted to reveal, and doing a spell out in the sun for revealing the truth, revealing the reality behind a situation, behind an intention, whatever, behind a feeling, it can be very helpful to use the sun for that. It can also mean that you should use magic right now to bring about success and positive change, because the sun basically embodies that. It embodies positivity, success, clarity. I think someone who has the sun card as their soul card might be a little bit stunted when it comes to shadow work. It might be a little bit more difficult to do shadow work for those people. So I think maybe it is worth it to look at the moon card as well and learn a little bit about, you know, how to use your intuition and not just what is on the surface. So I think this points to being naturally more talented at outward pointing, manifesting magic that brings about change. So something like candle magic, sigil magic, which is very heavy on the manifestation, the letting go, anything relating to the real world. And of course, also using, the sun for manifesting, spending time in the sun with sunscreen. I'm a big sunscreen proponent. And maybe even bleaching things in the sun. If you have a long-term spell, you could write it down on a piece of paper or put a sigil on a piece of paper and put that out where the sun hits it, like full front. And in like 2 weeks, you're not going to be able to read what it says anymore because the sun is just that strong, which is why we need sunscreen. Yes. So that could be an idea for a spell as well. Card 20, Judgment, a very serious card. If that is your soul card, of course, that also relates back to the 2, because 2 plus 0 is 2. So it might also be worth it to look at that. So judgment points to a path of very intense spiritual awakening, which can come from birth or can be something that comes later in life. And judgment is also sometimes associated with Scorpio. So it is all about that rude, sometimes rude, awakening, that intensity of change, of transformation, finding your purpose, you know? So your magic might be very concerned with finding the purpose of your life, or it should be concerned with that. And I think sometimes we forget that to find our life purpose, we can also do magic. We don't just sit around and journal and try to think what our life purpose is. We can also use magic to try and reveal that and to try and get information about what our life purpose might be. So judgment might be calling you to do that. It could also mean that you have a natural interest in the idea of what happens after death. You know, some people do not care about that at all, and some people do. And maybe you do if judgment is your soul card. And that also means that you have this connection to the unseen, the other world, that maybe you are very good at ancestral work, at healing generational trauma, at bringing about change and awakening in a time where that's very difficult. Because it's easy to just live an easy surface level life. But judgment is all about what is below that, the real purpose. So your magic might be very concerned with healing generational trauma, and making your life purposeful in that. Also, it could be about invoking spiritual beings. If you look at the card, of course, you see an angel usually depicted there. So whatever you believe in, whether it's angels, any other spiritual creatures, fairies, dragons, working with those kinds of beings could be beneficial if judgment is your soul card. If your number is 21, that is the World card. So of course, that kind of stands for completion and for a mastery of all magical practice and integrating many different aspects of magic into your practice. So anything from occult magic to herbalism to candle magic to water scrying to divination with runes, with tarot, whatever, all of that is kind of giving the complete picture of the world. So I think the world is an expression of being eclectic with the types of magic that you use. It's not like you are good at this and you should stick with that. More like the Wheel of Fortune, where it is associated with different energies, different elements. You may want to explore different topics that you feel drawn to get a complete picture of magic as a whole. You can also look at other cards to get some more inspiration, maybe draw another card to show you what you could focus on right now. And especially with the 21, you also relate to the Empress. 2 plus 1 is 3, so that's the Empress. You could also look at that. And I think the world in a magical context could point you towards looking at where your weaknesses are. Maybe you are great at journaling and at shadow work, but having a ritual, a true ritualistic spell, is difficult for you. Or maybe you love working with fire, but you never quite got along with water. So to get a complete picture and the most potent magic, this might be pointing you towards having to work on your weaknesses a little bit and rounding out your magical skill set. So do some reflection on where your weaknesses might lie in magic, what you don't like doing or what you usually don't feel drawn to, and just dabbling in it for the experience, seeing what it brings up, seeing what you can learn from that, doing a practice that is unusual for you. If you've never done candle magic and you love sigil magic, try to connect that maybe. Do a sigil and burn it in the candle and let the candle burn down. Put herbs on the candle. If you know nothing about herbalism, think about getting into that. You know, just kind of rounding out your magical practice with something unusual, which also kind of relates to the next card, the Fool, which I will talk about now. So if your number is 22, that stands for the Fool. As I explained in the beginning, the Fool is usually card zero, but for the purpose of it not being excluded, because you cannot get the zero as your birth card or your soul card, we will make it card 22, which is a common practice. So 22 being the Fool is of course about a very eclectic and a very free-spirited practice of magic. It's not about being good at one type of practice, but kind of dabbling in many. Also exploring new paths. In the World card just now, I spoke about exploring your weaknesses, and I think that's also worth it with a Fool. Exploring those parts of magic where you feel uncomfortable. Maybe you feel very comfortable doing shadow work, but you feel uncomfortable when it comes to doing a ritualistic spell or something like that. So trying that and kind of having this beginner's mindset is what I would recommend if you are drawn to the Fool, or if your soul card is the Fool. It can also be about using magic specifically to remove obstacles and to create courage within yourself to be a beginner, to take a new path. And using magic to bring that about is very easy. To bring about change within you can be so potent if you do a ritual or a spell with all elements, or just in your mind, where you ask for support in removing obstacles and removing fears that might keep you from your true path. I think the Fool also could point towards you being an example with your magic and with your practice, putting yourself publicly out there, maybe even on social media, even though some people might find it cringe, some people might find it awkward and be like, how can they do that? That's what the Fool is. People look at the Fool and see an idiot, but in the truer sense, it is an icon or a role model for all of us who want to be inspired to take action without fear. And I think it could mean that your magic lies within being that example for people. So be loud and proud about your magic, about your life. Experiment, share your path. Don't be one of those people who wants to explain and be a teacher all the time and strive for perfection. Just do it, just share what you are learning. So any kind of magic, any kind of exploration that you could do with mirror work, with occult magic, with candle magic, with elemental magic, with divination, all of that is worth sharing and being a beginner at, and explaining your path to other people and making your magic be the magic of just trying things. All right, thank you so much for watching. If you're watching everything, thank you. If you watched every single card, I'm proud of you. I hope that it gave you some inspiration. I would love to hear in the comments if there's something else that I didn't think of, that I didn't include, because this is in no way complete. It was just supposed to be a fun little inspirational exercise that we do together. So thank you so much for watching. Do subscribe, do like this video, and I will see you in the next one.